On December 7, 1854, the 200-foot-long wooden passenger steamer Westmoreland foundered during a winter gale in northern Lake Michigan, taking 17 of her crew and passengers with her. 17 of her crew and passengers survived, however, and stories soon began circulating that Westmoreland carried $10,000 in gold coins in her safe and 280 barrels of whiskey in her hold. 2 decades after the Westmoreland foundered, her first mate, Paul Pelkey, returned to search for the ship and her treasures. In 1872 and 1874, newspaper articles claimed the Westmoreland was discovered and salvaged, her engine and boilers delivered to a dock in Chicago. In 1936, 25-year-old Max Knoll and 19-year-old Jack Brown teamed up with an old salt from Frankfort, Michigan by the name of Captain George Waters and launched a search expedition to find the treasure ship. Cap Waters, who actually met the Westmoreland's first mate, Paul Pelkey, during the 1870s, claimed to know the exact location of the Westmoreland. The trio was said to have found the wreck and then used prototype dive gear to dive and explore the wreck site, which they described as a broken-up board pile. The following year, 1937, Jack Brown and Max Knoll founded the Desco Corporation. Desco, the diving equipment and salvage company in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, went on to be one of the biggest diving equipment manufacturers in the world. The 1950s brought a couple more expeditions to find the Westmoreland. In 1954, Captain Harold E. Van Nieman of Flint, Michigan, searched for and claimed to have located the treasure shipwreck. He said the wreck covered and uncovered with the sand and also claimed to have recovered a barrel and had it sent out to have its contents analyzed. Sadly, the following year, 1955, Van Nieman was arrested on fraud charges brought by the investors of his Westmoreland expedition. In 1957, Jim and Nancy Sawtell arrived in Frankfort, Michigan and spent more than a decade looking for the Westmoreland. The Sawtells are best known for creating shipwreck restaurant interiors and shipwreck furniture, which was sold in the Leland and Charlevoix areas. The 1960s, 70s, 80s, and 90s brought around a dozen treasure hunting expeditions to northern Michigan, but no claims of finding the ship or her treasures. On July 7, 2010, while side-scanning the waters near Sleeping Bear Dune, I ran over a large, ship-shaped target in nearly 200 feet of water. 3 days later, I journeyed back to the site to dive the mysterious underwater object. It was just me and my brother Bob on the boat. My plan was to dive down to the object, and if it was the Westmoreland, film the hogging arches, which would positively identify the target as the Westmoreland. We hooked the object, I suited up, and down the line I went. I looked down, and below me I saw the bow of an enormous ship. I only had a brief moment to look, then I went back to the ritual of clearing my ears, inflating my dry suit, and aiming my camera. I slowly made my way aft, surveying the wreck, and pondering if I was the first one to see this in the last 150 years. The forward cabins and pilot house were missing, and I saw the mast broken off about 6 feet above the deck. It was the same diameter as your typical telephone pole. The arches came into view. They rose about 12 feet above the deck, the passenger railing perfectly intact. There was a brace connecting the arches, a round tube about 6 inches in diameter. I reached out a hand and touched it. As I passed by, it was covered in quagga mussels. The deck appeared to be collapsed between the arches. I continued towards the stern. I wanted to see if the engine and boiler were still there. or if she was salvaged in 1874, as a newspaper report said. In the distance, the lifeboat davits appeared, the cranes used to launch the lifeboats. And there was a smokestack base, the smokestack plenum with a boiler right below it, and the engine cylinder right behind that, covered with a piece of deck, and those davits that came about 14 feet off the deck. The ship wasn't salvaged. I decided to go to the very stern. And out of the gloom appeared the auxiliary helm, a perfectly intact 4-foot ship's wheel. A single word raced through my mind: virgin. This was the Westmoreland, and she was a virgin wreck. Over the next 2 years, the Westmoreland revealed herself to us, her legend, her history, and her wreck site, an underwater museum, an ice water time capsule. The Westmoreland has been lying on the bottom of Lake Michigan, unmolested, since 1854. The auxiliary helm, not a spoke or spindle out of place. It's almost a miracle considering the Westmoreland went nearly vertical when she sank. The passenger railing, still intact around most of the ship. Quagga mussels cover much of the vessel now, hiding details, but giving us the incredible visibility we have in the Great Lakes today. The lifeboat davits. Eyewitnesses say one of the davits hooked the last lifeboat launch, flipping it over, throwing 15 of its passenger and crew into the icy water. They all drowned right here on the stern of the Westmoreland. Looking down, we see the propeller and the rudder. Just the bottom blades of the four-bladed propeller touch the sand. The Westmoreland lies on a very hard bottom. Looking at the stern, we see the rudder with its unusual two attachment points. With nearly 100-foot visibility, the Westmoreland reveals herself further. From the bottom of Lake Michigan to the top of the Hogging Arch is a remarkable 30 feet. The white oak construction of the Westmoreland has proven resilient, considering she spent over 15 decades in the bottom of Lake Michigan. A gangway is wide open, her hatch being blown off during the sinking. And we see the passenger deck collapse down onto the cargo deck. Eyewitnesses said passengers and crew members were clinging to the arches as the Westmoreland went down when she sank in that December storm in 1854. Cal Coltrati, a Milwaukee artist, created this beautiful image of the Westmoreland wreck site, showing us an opportunity to penetrate the bow area. With the bulwarks missing, it's easy to enter the Westmoreland, her portside anchor hanging down, woodstock aiming towards the bottom of Lake Michigan. A heavy coating of quagga mussels obscures the Westmoreland's oak timbers. The water temperature is 39 degrees as we enter a room that has been unseen by human eyes since over a decade before President Abraham Lincoln was assassinated. the windlass comes into view, covered in quagga mussels, chain still wrapped around it. Signs of the violent sinking are everywhere. Collapsed deck, pieces of wood laying all about. And there's a large cargo container, probably containing a cargo meant for the garrison at Mackinac Island. Behind that container, a staircase, still intact, rising up to the passenger deck. As we move towards the stern, we see a small opening to the yet unexplored bilge level.